for you.
Mr. Churchill said yesterday that parents should expect that if their child is sick, they're going to, with anything that looks like it could be COVID, they're going to have to keep their children out of school. In some cases, if they, you know, they could be off for 14 days. There's no paid sick leave requirement in this province. Many employers do have paid sick leave, but many do not. What can you say to parents who don't have paid sick leave? What, if anything, can the province do for them if they face requirement to be home with their children?
Well, part of the federal government restart program was 10 paid sick days, which would cover you for the 2 weeks. That's being administered by the national government, and they're doing it across the entire country.
Is that in place right now?
Yeah, COVID-related, yeah.
The NSTU, Paul Lossy, the president of the NSTU, said yesterday schools are in a state of chaos. Wondering whether or not you agree with that.
No, I don't agree with it at all. I want to thank those teachers across the province who have been in schools working and getting their classes ready, classrooms ready. Principals have been getting classrooms ready to welcome kids next week. Certainly, you know, people are, obviously there's anxiety. People are feeling towards that. It's the same as when we started up the economy and other things. That's all of a natural part of this. And I think it's not helpful when leaders kind of use that kind of rhetoric. They should be leading and working with parents and quite frankly, they're hardworking members who are actually out there doing it right now. Let's continue to work together as a province and ensure that our kids get back in school and in an environment that's safe.
Wozniak says that it's not safe for kids to return on Tuesday, and he's calling on the government to kind of reallocate two PD days in the beginning of next week to give teachers a little bit more time to get things ready. Is that something you would consider?
Teachers are getting ready right now. I have them in my family who haven't been in schools. I don't know what he's referring to. There's many hardworking teachers across the province who are preparing the classrooms now. No one in my constituency asked me for two more PD days and move PD days around. They're ready. They're welcome. They're ready to welcome kids, but obviously they're, you know, there's some anxiety associated with that, no question. You know, the rhetoric around schools being in chaos is just not helpful, not accurate.
If he's saying, if he's representing teachers and teachers are saying they need a couple more days to prepare, why wouldn't you consider that?
They're in the classroom today. They're in there working. They're in the classroom now. People are in setting up their classrooms. This is what happens every year. I don't know where he's coming from, but the teachers are in earlier. I want you to think about this for a second. We're going to welcome 130,000 young people back into our schools who have been out since March. And he's asking for two more days? Think about that for a second. Just think about that. That's his priority. Our priority is to continue to make sure that we work with parents and families to get their children back in school. Kids are ready to go back to school. We look forward to working with those teachers across the province and principals to ensure that families transition back into the education year.
So the union is also saying that several ventilation systems in schools haven't been inspected or repaired. Can you respond to that?
Listen, every year there's a national standard from air quality. Every year, it's not unique to this year. Every year we have to meet those standards. This is no different this year. We're working towards that. If there are issues that I don't know about, but if there's issues with the ventilation of a particular machine or whatever, of course we call on technicians to fix it like we do every year.
You're doing an assessment of the ventilation systems and the air quality in the schools. Will you make those reports public? I know lots of people have been asking for that.
Well, I don't have them, so I mean, that's a better question for the minister when he comes out later.
That's a better question
for the minister. I don't know whether he would even have access to them, but that's a good question for the minister.
Respectfully, it's not just Paul Wozniak who is making claims about the preparedness of teachers. We're all hearing from teachers from across the province. They're writing us, they're tweeting us, and they're telling us it's chaos. They're telling us they're not ready. They're telling us they have no idea what's going to happen on Tuesday. What do you make of that difference in narrative between what the Education Department is telling us and what the teachers themselves across the province are telling us?
In fairness, I'm sure there are teachers who are saying that. But you made a general statement that all the teachers across the province are in that position. That's just not true. That's not true, though. Teachers are out there working very hard to have their classrooms ready. Some of them, I'm sure, are upset. That's not a normal thing. This is a large workforce. There's some uncertainty associated with those as we start bringing kids back in. What I'm saying to you is, though, the kind of rhetoric that is being talked about is not helpful. We're going back to school. Let's work together with parents to lessen the anxiety that people are feeling as we work our way through this. And we'll continue to do so, and we'll follow the advice of public health as we've done all along, and we'll get our school year started.
Do you feel perhaps that statement downplays the concern that the teachers are expressing, those who are expressing concern?
Not at all. We've continued to listen. The minister has continued to work with teachers. He's heard from tens of thousands of Nova Scotians about the opening and restarting the school program, including teachers. I hear from them. Of course, we take their thoughts and their advice, and we will as the school year opens, as we start adjusting, if we need to adjust. But that's a far cry from the leadership of the union creating a bunch of noise and rhetoric that is not helpful for kids.
What's the rhetoric? Tell specifically.
Because schools are not in chaos. That's the irony. Schools are not in chaos. That's just simply not factual. Find me a school that's in chaos in the province. They haven't even opened yet.
There are serious concerns around whether social distancing can be maintained, policies about how schools are going to communicate with parents in the case of infections, that sort of thing. A lot of things are very unclear.
So we're going to continue to follow the advice of public health, like we started in March. And we're going to continue to work with Dr. Strang and the team to ensure that our kids are safe. And if there are concerns in particular schools, administration will bring it. We'll work with them. But that's the process as we start opening up. It is no different than other parts of our economy. When we opened it up, we adjusted them. And we'll learn as we go through this. But kids will be safe.
What do you think next week is going to look like in schools?
It'll be very different. Obviously, kids are coming with masks. Families are going to be coming feeling, some anxiety for some. There's no question. But we'll adapt and adjust to the reality of what's going to be there next week, as we will in the coming months. You've heard me say many times, this is about living with COVID. And how do we live with this virus until we get a vaccine at the same time, protecting the health and safety of our children and all citizens in our province, but also opening it up so that we can get back to learning.
If you don't go with the two-day recommendation to reallocate the two PD days next week, that he will file a policy grievance for unsafe working conditions. Any thoughts, any reaction to that?
No.
There's been any progress made on possibly opening up the Atlantic bubble, and whether at all just the reopening of schools and having all those bunches of people together, is that impacting at all the decision?
Yeah, I said here last week, we're welcoming thousands of university kids right now that are self-isolating in campuses and communities across the province that we're testing 3 times during this cycle. We'll be opening our classrooms next week, and somewhere around the middle of the 15th, around the 15th, I think all of the university kids who are coming in will be here and have gone through their 14 days. It'll give us a sense of that, and then we'll assess the Atlantic bubble in terms of opening up to the rest of the country at that point.
Looking at the latter half of September to take another look at.
Yeah, it won't be happening in the next couple of weeks for sure.
Obviously, your focus right now is on getting schools reopened, but we now know that there will be a health committee meeting next week. I'm just curious if you have any plans or a timeline for when Parliament will resume and what that could possibly look like.
No.
We're going to go to the phones. Jennifer Henderson with the Halifax Examiner. Do you have a question for the Premier?
Yes, thanks, Chrissy. Good afternoon, Premier McNeil. The safe restart agreement that the federal government announced the middle of July has hundreds of millions of dollars for provinces to apply for. At least I think that's what you need to do. You need to apply for it to increase capacity in a healthcare system before a second wave. Or to hire, there's also money to hire more staff in nursing homes or home care to prepare for a second wave. Has the province applied to this Safe Restart program for any money to help long-term care provide more spaces or provide more staff.
So you're talking about the Safe Restart agreement?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we signed on to that with the federal government. All provinces agreed with them across the country. It'd be delivered on a there's a base amount and then there's a per capita amount. Most of it is very specific on what we would use that for. Some of it is definitely as you describe about in the healthcare system. Minister DeLory and his team are working to continue to implement those changes, or quite frankly, some of it's buying PPE, some of it is around testing, ramping up testing models, all those kinds of things.
I mean, my question, though, pertains to whether any of the money is being sought to increase spaces or staff for long-term care homes.
So the federal money is not for that. We would look at, and the minister is looking at, long-term care. He'd be better one to be able to respond to that question. But the federal restart program was not related to that.
Does anybody else on the phone?
I don't know if that answers your question, Jennifer.
That helps us. Can I just follow up on the sick leave? Because the restart program also has money for sick leave, but it says that the province has to enact legislation or regulations.
No, we don't have to. We didn't have to make those changes. They've already existed in our province.
Does anybody else on the phone line have a question for the Premier? Back to the room.
More about the Safe Restart program. The amount we were told about back in mid-July was about $250 million, roughly, was what Nova Scotia could expect. Did that seem like a fair amount to you? It's about half of what we would expect if it was a straight per capita allotment.
I don't know the exact number, to be honest with you. It's been a while since we did it, but there's a base amount that was there, specifically in the five or six buckets that were associated with it, contact testing, healthcare system capacity in terms of ensuring around some of the stuff that Jennifer was just asking about, the vulnerable population, municipality and transit, PPE. So it's on the formula that we would be dealing with across the country. They dealt with the issue of a base amount early on, quite frankly, for some of the smaller provinces. But I can get you the exact number that it was.
Sure. I can also ask Minister Casey. I'm wondering also, what I understand, the money hasn't flowed yet. I don't believe we've reached a final.
I think in the finals that one province is waiting to sign on. We've signed on. And it's just an agreement there back and forth.
Are you concerned at all about the holdup? Some of this money was expected to flow to municipalities, for example. It's been 6 weeks.
We would like to have had it flow 6 weeks ago. That's why we signed the agreement after we reached the agreement. But they're working with our sister provinces across the country, and it's my understanding that there's one final letter to be received from a province to start the money flowing.
I want to talk about long-term care homes for a second. People whose parents are in long-term care are comparing what's happening there to the province's own definitions of elder abuse. The isolation they're experiencing, the physical impacts of that. And I understand that long-term care homes are following the guidance of public health. But when we look at schools, we as a province made the decision to reopen, knowing that that comes with risks, and then to do the best we can around those risks. I wonder why a similar consideration isn't being given to long-term care homes, accepting the risk that comes with more freedom of visitation, and then just doing the best to work around that.
So you're dealing with the population in long-term care that would have potentially many, many health issues, which we know the virus has a very different reaction to those individuals than someone who's healthy. So but we'll continue to follow what public health is doing. You're right. There's no, I don't agree with the issue around elder abuse, the comment associated with that, but there is no question that this has been hard on families, all of our families who have people in long-term care facilities. We're used to being able to go in whenever we want and to be able to be with them. This has been a huge change, but as we all know all too well, when the virus gets into a long-term care facility, the consequences are deadly in some cases. So, you know, public health is being very cautious. I know that Dr. Strang is looking at this issue around long-term care, and one of the things that we can do to kind of, we'll never get back to the way it was prior to March, but how can we support those families to provide some care and, quite frankly, just to have that human contact with their loved one?
Seniors in homes were to assert their autonomy as free Nova Scotians and say, we want to accept those risks. And you know, we want the freedom to visit, to go for a coffee, to do those things. Like, their freedoms are being restricted, you know, against their will here.
Well, there are people allowed in nursing homes today. Those adjustments and restrictions have been adjusted for families, and Dr. Strang will continue to work with his colleagues across the system to ensure that happens. You know, these are very real issues around what the residents are feeling. But quite honestly, what their families are feeling. We're working to ensure that we can try to get back to that, at the same time making sure that we protect the health and safety of those residents. They are in our care.
One of the big problems is that people are saying there's not enough staff to accommodate these visits. And they say that if the government would fund more positions, then these facilities, long-term care facilities, could allow more visits. Because, I mean, right now, for example, in Northwood, residents get one 30-minute supervised visit a week, and I don't think that's adequate.
You don't think it's adequate? Those families probably don't as well. I think it's this isn't about this is about them and how we make those adjustments. If the issue is someone being able to administer a appointment, then we can continue to work with those facilities if that's what it's related to. This is also, let's be clear, it is also about the health and safety of those residents and working with those families. Listen, I've got 200 long-term care beds in the constituency that I represent. I know many of those families that have had major adjustments to their interaction with their loved one. We don't do that lightly. It's something that we've continued to work with Dr. Strang, and we'll work with our partners. This is not, he's not spending his time trying to make life hard on people. He's spending his time to ensure that we can protect the safety of our loved ones. And each family's circumstances are different, we'll continue to work with them to try to ensure that we can get that interaction more frequently with their loved ones, as we have lifted the number of people who were allowed in. Those are the kinds of things that we'll continue to do, and he'll continue to loosen the restrictions when he feels that we're ready for that.
His authority to restrict the freedoms of seniors or residents in long-term care, does that stem from the fact that the facilities are licensed by the province? And would the consequences of residents saying, you know what, I'm going to go get ice cream with my kids, would the consequences of that be simply that they are no longer allowed to stay in those facilities because they've broken the rules?
That's a hypothetical question. The issues fall under the public health has a responsibility for the health and safety of all of us, whether we live in a long-term care facility or whether we live out in the community. That's why those restrictions early on to lock our province down was how do we deal with the issue of this virus that is with us. And we certainly know that in some environments, when that virus gets in there, it's deadly. So public health has the ability and is enacting that to provide those restrictions and lifting them gradually when they seem it's safe.
My question is, does the authority to create restrictions for people in long-term care versus the rest of Nova Scotians, does that stem from the fact that the province licenses the long-term care facilities?
I don't think it is. It has to do with public health. I don't know the specific details about that. I can ask you. Public health has the authority to provide restrictions as we did.
Live in a certain place and not restricting people the same way who don't live in
right, which we have all through the entire system. So it's public health has that authority if they believe that particular environment requires more restrictions. That's in essence what we're talking about, keeping people safe. We will continue to work through Dr. Strang and his team as we go through this.
We have a question.
I will tell you,
this is
an issue, quite honestly, that is keeping all of us awake. It's not something that any of us, enjoy. Of course, we want to see people to be able to see their parents and grandparents and have that interaction that, quite honestly, they deserve to have. But at the same time, as you well know, that if that virus gets into a facility, you're going to be then blaming Dr. Strang and I. The questions will turn on us then. So you have to strike that balance of how do we protect the public safety at the same time, governing this thing and working through this thing as the virus changes, the system changes, with the heart that we're known for as a society. And we'll continue to do that. And no one will be happier that when I can say to families and Dr. Strang says to families that we've now lifted some of these restrictions and people can get back to showing the care and love to the family member.
Thank you, Premier. That's all the time that we have today for the questions for the Premier. We now have Minister Delory in the room. And you can begin asking your questions.
Minister, I wonder if your department has the capacity or ability to immediately hire more staff for long-term care facilities so that families could visit more frequently because the staffing and space issues would be reduced.
As a department, throughout the first wave and ongoing, we've stayed in contact and engaged with the continuing care sector, and staffing is one of those areas that we've been responsive to. As it relates to additional staffing specifically to the area of visitation, which doesn't necessarily require the same level of support as the ongoing that continuing care assistance and nursing staff within the facility would provide, based upon last year's expert panel review and recommendation, they did recommend a different classification of staff that could be brought in, and we did authorize and approve additional staffing with that category, that level of staffing, which I think many facilities have taken advantage of, specifically to your point, to assist with facilitating visits within their facilities.
Staff have been hired during the pandemic for that purpose.
I would have to go back and take a look to see what the specific number is.
So there's a separate review from Northwood of, and the review covers province-wide
infection prevention control,
yeah.
IPC.
So, and I'm wondering who's on that review panel and have they started the review and will the report be made public this month?
Yeah, as reported when we announced both reviews, the Northwood as well as the IPC infection prevention control review, they're both expected to have results back this month. So that work is ongoing. The IPC review is leveraging experts here within the province, within the department and our partners throughout the health system. As far as the specific names, I don't have them off the top of my head. There'd be a lot of engagement as they do that work across the province. Yeah, the work is well underway. It's well underway. As I said, we expect to get results back this month.
Will be made public, document?
Look, our first priority of the work that we do is focused on getting this information and helping it inform the actions that we need to take to respond to the COVID pandemic. That's where our priority on this is. As far as making documents public before they become forward, we have legislation in place, the FOIPOP legislation, that ensures that there are provisions around the release of public documents. So provided that it falls within the purview of that legislation for release publicly, of course it would adhere to that.
What document is going to be made public?
As I said, we don't have a document yet. Such a document, like all information that would be made public, would go through a FOIPOP review to ensure that the appropriate legislation is adhered to. So I can't tell you for what the status or the outcome of a document that I haven't seen yet, because it's not even completed. So you're just a few weeks too early with your questions.
Would your department consider funding training for designated family caregivers in infection prevention control, proper PPE protocol, just to make it safer for them to care for their loved ones in LTCs?
Yeah, as noted, we have a review underway right now looking at the infection prevention control, IPC, specifically with an eye to the long-term care sector. So that review, along with the Northwood review, will help inform what steps we take going forward to ensure we meet the safety and the needs of the residents of those facilities while working with the administrators and the staff there as well.
There's a new study that shows that COVID can be transmitted from minks to human beings. So, and as you know, there's several mink farms in the province. So I'm wondering, are you guys, or is the government or your department looking at like developing, you know, protocols around testing these animals and other safeguards that might prevent potential spread?
So as it relates to the transmission of the COVID between humans and other animals. As with many aspects of this virus, research is ongoing and still developing. What I believe you're referring to is some studies that started in Europe over the last month or so, seeing that minks have been found to have positive cases of COVID. That's expanded. I think there's two or three jurisdictions in the world that have identified it. In Canada, there's been no identified instances like that. And within the province of Nova Scotia, the prevalence of COVID is quite low. The vast majority of our mink farms are in the western zone, which is also an area of the province that has one active case right now. That means, again, the risks are very, very low of the possibility of transmission. And even in the research that's being done, the risks and the prevalence based upon that research to date shows that the likelihood of the transmission, although possible, between animal and to human, it does still remain low. The most frequent and identified area of transmission is between humans. And so that's the area that public health has its main focus on, while our public health officials continue to monitor and stay on top of all research that they can, including this work. And that's why, officials in the Department of Agriculture have had conversations with the association governing mink farmers to make sure they're aware of the circumstances. And again, to remind all of those workers who we care about to take the precautions, even if the risk is low, the appropriate precautions, hand washing, hygiene, and so forth are critical.
More people in terms of testing, follow-up, and contact tracing, knowing that, you know, we have thousands of students coming from out of province who are all going to have to be tested multiple times?
Yeah, we actually started that work earlier. Staffing and the distribution of staffing varies as we've gone through the pandemic, where the needs are and so forth. It's actually one of the advantages that we have of having two health authorities, but the Nova Scotia Health Authority as the main service provider delivering frontline operational care across the province, because we're able to be flexible with the staff supporting our testing centers. But indeed, we have been engaged with more training and staffing, and we've been proceeding. I think today we were up to about 1,300 tests from yesterday, which is showing that, as you said, with students being back and the testing protocol that we have for them, if you look at the testing data in our news releases, you're seeing that steady increase in the number of tests performed, which correlates with the number of students coming back.
We're going to go to the phones. Does anybody on the phone have a question for Minister DeLory?
I do, please, Chrissy.
Jennifer, go ahead with your question.
Minister DeLory, I just want to know whether the Department of Health intends to allocate any of the money from the federal Safe Restart Program towards hiring more staff in long-term care homes or providing more space in long-term care homes so it reduces the risk from the room sharing. Seems to me that some of that money, you know, is targeted towards vulnerable populations and targeted towards reducing infection from a potential second wave. So I'm just curious to know if you are planning to allocate any of that money towards long-term care.
Yes, I can confirm that through our work with the federal government that we will have investments, obviously, towards our long-term care sector. As we've spoken a little bit earlier, and as you'd be aware, there are two reviews ongoing as it relates to the COVID pandemic, in our long-term care sector. One is the Northwood Review, the other is the Infection Prevention Control. Both of those reviews we expect to get back to the department this month, and that information will help inform where we need to focus our investments going forward. So that'll help inform specifically where we'll be making some of those investments like you've asked. But in the meantime, I want to also let Nova Scotians know that throughout this pandemic, we've continued to invest and shift our resource investments into the long-term care sector, including additional allocation of resources for PPE, the staffing resources allocation to help support the facilities, both when we wrapped our arms around facilities with outbreaks, but also as a part of the opening up and visitors providing opportunity for long-term care facilities to tap into a new classification of employee to help support those family visitations.
Jennifer, do you have any more questions for Minister DeLory?
Yeah, was there any money to allow, I mean, I know there was a new classification, but did homes get any more actual dollars to allow them to hire the people?
Yes, and we did that during and throughout the pandemic with provincial resources. As part of our pandemic, the finance minister had a forecast update earlier this summer where she noted the increased spending we have made as a province, much of that in the Department of Health, as part of our COVID response. So we have made additional investments this year already to navigate the first wave, and indeed, as we've come out of the first wave, preparing for the second.
Back to the room. Any more questions for Minister DeLory?
Newfoundland and Labrador are starting to use the national COVID-19 alert app today. Any idea when Nova Scotians will be able to use it?
I don't have a specific date. Certainly, we are very familiar. The app itself, anyone can go down and download it and install it today, so the application. The piece of work that's outstanding is with the I guess the process within our public health division for how the, I'll call it a key or a code that has to be provided to an individual who's been found positive so that they then load that code into their app. So it is the process of getting that's being worked out at this time. But again, the work is well underway, and you know, we'll support that through our public health as they do. But they do have a focus on a lot of work, and that's one of the pieces they're working on, and we expect in the not too distant future, and we'll announce that when it's ready.
Sounds
So the province's own policy on visitations to long-term care homes doesn't put any, has any specific restrictions on the amount of visits that a resident can have and the duration of those visits. But you're seeing at Northwood that visitors are only allowed one visit per week for half an hour. And so I'm wondering if you can tell me, what are the particular barriers at Northwood, for example, restricting these visits when the own policy doesn't have any of those?
Well, I think if you step back and look at the operation of long-term care facilities outside of the current reality we're living in, facilities always maintained and managed their own operational policies as it would relate to visitation and so forth. So what we saw throughout the first wave of the pandemic and is still the case was the introduction throughout society, including the continuing care and long-term care sectors, of public health directives to help stem the spread of coronavirus and protect our citizens. But what we've seen as the first wave has wound up, we've seen a gradual loosening of those restrictions as well, including with visitation in the long-term care sector. So public health will continue to monitor and make recommendations as Dr. Strang updates his orders and his directives to further ease them when it's appropriate in Nova Scotia. And as it relates to the specific aspect of what barriers and challenges a specific facility may have, or the rationale of why they've adopted the specific policies that they have underneath the orders that are in place, would be best directed to those specific facilities.
That's all the time that we have today for questions for Minister Delory. We now have Minister Fiore, and we'll now go to questions in the room.
Minister, I wonder what progress has been made on the public inquiry into the shooting.
We continue to work with our federal colleagues. I would say we're making significant progress, but still some work to do.
What?
There's a number of elements, the terms of reference being the most significant. In standing up an inquiry, there's a significantly bigger infrastructure from a federal perspective that has to be put in place. So that's taking time, and I know they continue to work with that focus.
Can you elaborate on the infrastructure? What work is being done? Are people being hired? Is budget being allocated? Just as much detail as you can give there.
That's all part of the process. I don't have the specific details, as that's a federal responsibility within the joint inquiry process.
So they're not keeping you in the loop on that?
They keep government in the loop, but I don't have the specifics of what the federal government is doing and is responsible for.
Another commissioner been appointed?
Not at this time, no.
Is the search underway for a new commissioner?
Yes, we have submitted a name as a provincial nominee for that third position, and we're waiting on the federal government to make those decisions.
Can you tell us who it is?
Not at this time, no.
The other thing is, have you contacted the Conflict of Interest Commissioner to see whether you may have a conflict in this inquiry?
No, I have not.
There's been a lot of people, well, not a lot of people, but there have been people raising questions and being concerned about that, and that's, I guess, under the Act, it's enough to, if there are people that are concerned that there's a perceived conflict of interest, that should at least get a opinion from the Conflict of Interest Commissioner. So yeah. I guess what's stopping you from asking, just simply asking for an opinion?
So I've gone to the Conflict of Interest Commissioner on two previous occasions, one for the Glen Assoon matter, and in general, the Conflict of Interest Commissioner determined that there was no conflict, perceived or real, simply because of my previous employment. I've been guided by that advice, and I continue to apply that advice to this day in these circumstances. This matter is certainly a different set of circumstances, but doesn't change the principal direction and guidance that the Conflict of Interest Commissioner has provided me.
You could argue that, from my understanding, you didn't have any direct dealings or with the Assoon case, like you weren't involved in that case at all, but you would be, you would have been involved on some level with the policing in Nova Scotia. So, and given your past history as a former RCMP officer, those are, it's a different set of circumstances, so.
But your statement in itself is conflicting. You're saying, because I was a former police officer dealing with the Porta Peak matter and the inquiry, that I have a conflict, but that I don't, and I'm confident, satisfied that I don't, given the guidance and direction of the Conflict of Interest Commissioner. I continue to apply that guidance in these very circumstances.
All I'm saying is that some people would say, think, as you're the Justice Minister and you have, you're responsible for the policing of, for policing in Nova Scotia, you're a former RCMP officer, that's different than the Assun case. I don't think you were involved in that case at all.
Right? I wasn't involved. I haven't been involved in the investigation around the Porta Peak matter either.
On the phone, have a question for Minister Fury.
It's Jennifer Henderson, Minister. My question is with respect to concerns around the RCMP's destruction of evidence in the Glen Assun case that came to light publicly over a year ago, last July. And as the minister responsible for policing in Nova Scotia, can you tell us if you've ordered an investigation or made any attempt to find out how that destruction of evidence occurred?
I haven't ordered an investigation. My focus and priority with regards to the Assun matter has been negotiations with our federal colleagues and Mr. Assun's counsel as we advance a settlement in this matter.
Jennifer, go ahead with your follow-up.
Yeah, I appreciate that, and I recognize the importance of that. But at the same time, why have you not inquired to find out? I mean, doesn't that reflect on the administration of justice? We need to know what happened there so someone can be held accountable. Is it your intention, I guess, Minister, to make those inquiries?
Not at this time.
Does anybody else on the phone line have a question for Minister Fury? Back to the room.
Minister, the inquiry was called under federal legislation, but it is a joint provincial inquiry. Can you tell us exactly what the role of the province is from here?
Certainly. The joint inquiry would apply responsibilities on both the federal and provincial government. The federal government, looking after or responsible for oversight of the five federal agencies, the RCMP, Canada Border Service Agency, the Alert Ready System, the Criminal Intelligence Service Canada Program, the fifth one slips my mind, and they would be required through their processes to present an order in council to the federal cabinet to advance that. And that would include the elements that you referenced earlier, the standing up of a secretariat, the hiring of staff, the budget for those elements, as well as the overarching administration of the inquiry. The province would be required to apply a similar parallel OIC process that would have to go before cabinet, and it would be focused on those areas of provincial responsibility, domestic violence, those types of elements that have been brought forward and identified. That's the dual role that we would have. Typically in the past, when both the federal legislation and the provincial legislation are applied in joint inquiries, both of those processes would identify the same panel, and then the panel would conduct their work through the course of the inquiry, and then they would report back to both the federal minister and provincial minister.
As the federal government works on setting up the infrastructure of the inquiry, as you mentioned, what work is going on in Nova Scotia?
So we're doing the same parallel work. We have to build an order and council document. We have to prepare that paperwork and documentation to present to cabinet. That will come as this process unfolds. But we continue to contribute to and review the terms of reference and some other legal paperwork that's associated to this process.
Halfway through the TORs, three-quarters?
No, I'm pretty confident that we're in the final stages of finalizing the TOR, the terms of reference, and I'm hoping with the federal government's cooperation, identification of the third panel member, that we could see some early progress.
Does the provincial government and the federal government share equal authority on the terms of reference, on deciding what's in the terms of reference?
Yes, we've both contributed to, no different than we did with the terms of reference under the former review. We've both contributed to, shared the contents of that document and updates to that document, and there has been agreement and consensus throughout that process.
But does the federal government have final say on terms of reference?
No, it's been truly a joint initiative and joint effort. I've been very pleased with the progress specific to the terms of reference.
Minister, forgive me if this came up the last cabinet meeting. I wasn't here. Are you interested in running for the leadership?
You know, Brian, I have two priorities as we speak. First and foremost, as the MLA for the constituency of Lunenburg West, and equally at the direction of the Premier, responsible for the role of Attorney General and Minister of Justice. Those are my priorities, and I have no interest in seeking the leadership of the Liberal Party.
That is all the time we have for questions for Minister Fury today. Up next,
you,
we have Minister Churchill. Going to questions in the room. Go ahead.
Okay, the teachers' union is looking for 2 days. They want to move 2 PD days that were previously scheduled for later in the school year to early next week to give teachers a bit more time to repair. Is that something you would consider doing?
We do not have an operational or an epidemiological reason to consider that at this point. We've had our plan and guidelines out now for over a month. We've also had principals, cleaning staff, operational staff that have come in early. Principals and VPs have been there for a couple weeks and have been answering questions and communicating with local families and their staff. So I believe there's been ample time to get prepared for this. And I think based on what I'm hearing from our principals, from our operational leads, our regional executive directors, our system is ready to welcome students back on September 8th. And I think that's a date that parents and students have had, and many teachers have had circled for a while and are excited to get back.
How many schools have you visited in the last week?
In the last week, I have not been at any schools personally myself. I've been in regular contact with our operational folks and getting reports from every region of the province on the back-to-school plan and preparedness. And we've got reports from schools and from principals. All those reports are encouraging at this point.
Mr. Wozni says schools are in chaos right now. What do you make of that?
Very different than what we're hearing from our principals. We had media visit schools in every region of the province yesterday. Schools open up their doors to, you know, show the public what they're going to look like, and I think we're in very good shape here.
The Premier, you know, said it's not unusual for a large workforce to have many staff members who raise concerns, specifically with regards to teachers and going back to school. I wonder what you make of the fact that so many teachers are telling us as journalists that they're not ready and they're not prepared and they're not going to be ready by the time school opens. What do you make?
Well, what's the reason that they're giving for that? I'd be curious to know that.
Well, Well, lots are saying that, you know, the PPE is not in place, the ventilation's not ready. I know you've said that those things are going to come in quite confidently over the weekend, but they're saying they have no idea what it's going to look like when kids arrive. They don't understand how the staggered lunches and classes are going to work. The kids are too close together. They don't know how they're supposed to enforce the protocols around masking.
So, I mean, there a lot of those questions can be easily answered in the back-to-school guidelines and documentations that have been provided to the public and to teachers and staff for well over a month now. Principals came back in early to help get their staff and their schools ready for September 8th, knowing that this was the start date that we'd chosen. And, you know, I believe, based on the feedback I'm getting from our operational leads, our regional executive directors, and the majority of principals, at least from the principals association, that we are ready to go and that people have had time to prepare for this.
If they're not feeling prepared, it's their own fault?
I certainly didn't say that.
Okay, but if they're not feeling prepared, do you have any reason to, like, why wouldn't they be feeling prepared if there is that document out there?
I can't answer that question myself, obviously. You know, I've actually been really impressed with what our frontline staff are doing. You know, principals and VPs cut their summer short to get back into school and get these schools ready. Our cleaning staff, our operational staff have been going above and beyond to make sure our schools are clean, they're taped, ventilation systems are checked and maintained, and to answer questions that are coming in locally on from everything what recess is going to look like to you know, how food's going to be distributed. So a lot of work has been happening the last 2 weeks that I think put us in a very good position for September 8th. And it's, I know it shouldn't be a surprise to anybody that September 8th is our start time, because we indicated that over a month ago.
Minister, I want to ask you about the funding for reopening. You said yesterday $40 million is how much the province is spending. I think you've given that number before. We found out a few weeks ago that the federal government is going to kick in almost $48 million into this. Could you try to square those two numbers? Why are we appear to be spending less than what we're receiving?
Those are two separate pots of money. So the $40 million that we announced was additional money that the province was putting in for COVID preparedness, hiring more cleaners, increasing our substitute list, purchasing supplies for students so that we don't have to share. So the federal dollars are on top of that and are welcomed, of course, and they will be used. I mean, we haven't received all the money, but the first round is going to be used particularly for busing, more bus drivers, and more time in between cohorts being dropped off at school to make sure that sanitation's happening on our buses. We'll also be hiring more cleaners with these dollars as well. And right now we're planning on securing more devices for students in the event that we have to move to a blended learning or at-home learning model to make sure that folks have access to the tech they need.
I did want to ask you about the devices. You'd mentioned that, I believe, yesterday, that about 14,000 computers are going to be purchased. That's a pretty big order. I'm wondering when it's being placed, how you're going to acquire them, and how quickly you hope to get them.
So I know I received an update recently that has 10,000 of those devices already distributed to schools, and I think the additional four are being formatted before they're delivered. So the vast majority of those devices are in schools, is what I understand from the regional reports.
Do they come from a single vendor?
I'm not certain. I'm not sure. We'll get someone to follow up with you on that.
Okay, finally, I just want to make sure I understand with the number question. So you expect it's going to be about $88 million is going to be spent in total on the restart?
I mean, that's what it's looking like at this point, you know. So that's what I know at this time.
Mr. Trudeau,
about at-home learning and a blended learning model. When it comes to snow days, inclement weather days, and the school is physically shut down, will those days become at-home learning days where, you know, the tools are already mostly in place?
Well, you know, I think we have to rethink learning from that perspective. We learned a lot last year on what works, what doesn't work with at-home learning. We will be enhancing our virtual and online learning opportunities and resources, and so I think that's a conversation that's going to be ongoing over this year, for sure. What can we accomplish from being at home? What have we learned, and how can we ensure that the teaching and learning environment for our students is optimized? You know, even if maybe they do have to be at home.
I just want to ask the difference. Just want to ask you about the Council on African Canadian Education. I think there's about 12 vacancies on that board, and there's supposed to be 17 seats filled. So I'm wondering, what are the factors that are delaying you from filling those seats?
We want to get those filled. I mean, really, our all the energy in the department has been diverted to last year being in crisis response to COVID, and over the summer being focused on COVID preparedness and the back to school plan. So we're going to get back on that and get those names approved as soon as we can.
How many applications do you have at the moment?
I'm not certain about the number of applications.
So just the last question. About the fact that I've talked to a former committee member who said that for the past 3 years they haven't had quorum, right? And this is like a legislated board, right? That's supposed to be.
I don't think that's accurate for that time period. I mean, I've met as recently with that group last year. So I don't believe it's been that long. You know, we are late in getting those appointments in right now. And I just hope people understand that attentions have been focused elsewhere during this time. But we'll get that process moving. We want those positions filled as soon as we can at this point.
Going to the phones, does anybody have a question for Minister Churchill?
Yeah, I'll ask a question. Cyril Cole with the Amherst News. Mr. Churchill, just looking for an update on the Spring Hill School project. I understand there might have been another small delay regarding the sewer system in Spring Hill.
So I haven't been made aware of any other delays. Going on memory here, Daryl, we have a site that's been selected. And next phase will be soliciting input on design for the school.
Thank you.
Jennifer, did you have a question for Minister Churchill?
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up on the schools thing. There's been some concern about whether there are enough sinks, enough washrooms to accommodate more frequent hand washing among children and students. Has the department ordered any portable hand washing stations like we'd see at a, you know, summer festival or, you know, on outdoor sites that could be brought in where there aren't sinks in every room or that sort of thing? I'm just wondering if you have made an order for those portable hand washing stations.
We have, so there will be hand sanitization stations at every class and at every entrance for the school. So that, and we're encouraging people obviously sanitize on the way in, on the way out, and as they enter and exit classes as well.
Just to be clear, so we're not at cross purposes, I'm not talking about hand sanitizer on the wall like you'd see in a hospital, but I'm talking like a sink, a portable sink where you can use soap and water to wash your hands.
I mean, I don't know that. I'm not sure the specifics of the hand sanitization stations, but I do know that the appropriate products have been ordered and for the most part have been delivered to our schools.
Back to the room. Any more questions for Mr. Churchill?
Minister, I just want to talk really quickly about the lead issue. What impact has the pandemic had on the fact that it's going to be a couple of weeks late, that database?
So I think we committed to the database, you know, in September. All the testing has been completed, and they're just in the process of finalizing that database, and it should be up you know, in relatively short order.
Do you know how much that database is going to cost?
I don't think it would be a consequential amount. It's just it's going to be a pretty simple, straightforward database that people can access online. So I don't think that's not where the cost associated with this stuff is. The cost would be in, you know, remediation or providing water if or where that's needed.
Yesterday you said you believe that all the testing has been done. Today you say it has been done. I just want to
confirm that the testing's been complete.
I'm doing a bit of catch-up on leadership. I was away for a bit of August. Are you interested in...
I mean, it's... my attention has been focused elsewhere right now. You know, we've got a lot of families depending on us to get the back-to-school plan right. We've got our staff, everybody really... you know, dependent on the work being done here. So, you know, my duty to the department and this ministerial portfolio has been the priority. We still have some time to think about leadership. I think the deadline is October 9th. So, you know, I'm going to stay focused on where I'm at right now. And if I do reach a conclusion on that, I'll inform people for sure.
What interests you about possibly running for leadership?
Well, I mean, it's an ability to you know, lead an agenda, and that's pretty exciting. You know, I think there's a lot of structural changes that would be interesting and consequential to go after in terms of how government works. So, I mean, that's stuff that I'm interested. I mean, I'm not going to get any specifics at this point, but I mean, it's, you know, anyone that's involved in this business, whatever anybody wants to say about politicians of any stripe, you know, it's about having impact on your community, on your province, and of course, being in a leadership role is the best, you know, is the highest way to have that sort of impact. So, I mean, that's something that I think, you know, I do want to spend some more time thinking about at this point, but my focus has been elsewhere. It's been on the job here, and you know, that's what I'm going to be focused on until I feel I've got some breathing space to think about other things.
Thank you, Minister. That's all the time we have for questions.
Thanks.
For Minister Churchill.
Minister, are you considering a run at leadership?
A run at leadership? Look, if it was 10 years ago, I would. But I'm not interested in this time.
You going to run again?
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's the plan.
Premier Peel.
Well, it's a tremendous opportunity for anybody who would be interested in public service. It doesn't happen too often where a leadership review elects a premier, so it's a tremendous opportunity, and I'll be participating from the sidelines.
Minister, I wanted to ask you about the capital spending. There was a lot of money to be spent this summer, both through the capital plan and through the stimulus funding that was announced a little bit later. And I'm just wondering how much of that you're going to be able to spend.
Well, and that's the excellent question, Brian, because it's one thing to have access to the capital, but it's another thing to deploy it. And that's always a challenge to get it out with all the considerations that we have in Nova Scotia. I'm speaking specifically about seasonality. However, I'm so pleased at this point with our people and our department who dedicated themselves through the isolation piece. And on the capital spending, of course, this is the largest capital budget that we've seen in the province, and at this point we're on track to spend the program, working with all the various departments. On the highway side in particular, we've been able to deploy almost all of our capital. We intend to get it all out. And we've had excellent cooperation from the contracting community and from the road builders. And we will a little bit later on, towards the end of this month, we'll be able to say with some finality just where we're at. But we're well down the road. The last update I had put us at around 85% out. On the stimulus, we have over 200 projects deployed with the stimulus money, which was $230 million. And all of the money is committed, and our target is to have it spent before the end of the current fiscal year, which, of course, the 1st of April. The list is a work in progress, depending on what the situation is. More projects are being added. Some are being dropped if they're not ready. But we've had great success this summer with getting projects out the door.
Can you promise the people of Nova Scotia that the Cat Ferry will run next season?
Well, it's our intention with the ferry to be in a position to run next year. We with the onset of COVID, which changed everything, I'm hesitant to say, just where we will be at that point in time. Obviously, that connection is to the U.S. We know the struggle that they're having with their COVID handling, but it's our intention that if it's safe, that we'll be ready.
Do you have a sense of how much cost could be, piled on as the ferry continues to sit idle, or what our financial picture will look like in the spring with regards to the ferry?
Yeah, and again, that's a good question. This year, because of the call that was made to discontinue the service, put us in a better position to assess what expenditures were essential and which ones we could modify or decrease. And we're having some success at that. I haven't got a report yet, but we're expecting to reduce the projected cost on that service because of the fact that we knew we weren't going to go. Last year, we kept waiting and waiting and eventually had to pull it. But we had incurred the cost by that time. This year, we're in a little bit better position. Eventually, I'll be able to be more precise about what kind of expenditure we have for the current fiscal year.
Going to the phones, to Daryl Cole. Daryl, I believe you have a question for the minister.
Yes, Mr. Hines, a year ago, drilling was done on the side of the Trans-Canada Highway in Oxford just to check for the possibility or potential of sinkholes around the highway. The report's been promised several times, but it hasn't been released yet. When will that report be released?
Well, it's with our professional services group now, Daryl, and it's in the draft form, hasn't been finalized, people in the area might notice that we are doing some ditching around the area and doing some shave and pave along to improve the highway surface there. We continue to monitor the condition of the 104 in that section daily, and as we've done for many years. And on the initial review from staff, there is no danger to the traveling public in that section.
But I guess the question for the minister? The area would have, Mr. Minister, is what's taking so long for it to be completed?
Well, it's often, and I understand how people feel that way, but it takes a while to, when you're doing a significant analysis, such as what's being done there, the data's got to be checked and rechecked, and, it's a fairly complex process, so that takes a little bit of time to get it done.
Any more questions on the line from Daryl?
Yeah, just one more. Mr. Minister, do we expect that it might come out in the next couple of months? Because I know when you and I talked last September, at that time it was hopefully maybe by the end of December, and then I think it was maybe the end of February, then it was into June, then the end of summer. I guess, is there a timeline on when it may be made public?
No, I can't give you a timeline, other than to assure you that if the report turned up any imminent danger, you would see us reacting to that. So we'll get it out when we have satisfied ourselves that the information that we have is all verifiable.
And that's all the time that we have for questions.
Mr. Oh, I just have one more question about the crane. It's been a year now since that crane came down. Where is that report on what went wrong?
Yeah, we are in a waiting for labor to conclude their review. We don't have that yet, and we have a commitment to recover the approximately $2 million that we spent to get that thing down from there. But until we have the technical review that's being done by labor, it's very difficult for us to determine what the target would be for recovery. So once we get that, Brian, we'll have a better chance of being able to answer that question a little bit more definitively.
You asked where that report is. A year seems like a very long time to wait.
Yeah, it's with the Labor Department. And again, it's the same thing as what Daryl is talking about there. These seem like inordinate times, but when people are making these kinds of considerations in that instance, which may trigger litigation, then you've got to make sure that they have it right. So I will tell you I can't say when we will have it, but the labor folk know that we're waiting impatiently.
Thanks, Minister. Next up, we'll have Minister Porter.
Yeah, Minister, I want to ask you about municipal aid. Municipalities have been asking since the spring for more assistance. I understand that municipal aid was part of the agreement reached with the federal government back in mid-July. 6 weeks have gone by. Can you tell municipalities how much they can expect once that agreement is finalized?
I don't have a figure of what that will end up with. The restart program, Brian, you're referring to there? I don't know what that figure will be, but I do know from what I have researched that it is close. We'll soon be making an announcement on that. They're working on that. It's certainly been a priority with the feds in our discussion, our need for municipal funding. We have worked with them since COVID began and in the months forward with regards. We've asked them for what their shortcomings were, the shortfalls were, and we've worked with them. We've created the $380 million very low interest loan package for them to be able to continue to offer programs and services. They could certainly use that if they felt the need for the election. If, you know, there's some talk about extra costs for the election to take place. I'm not sure. I haven't seen any figures around that yet, but I have heard some rumors that municipalities are experiencing a bit more cost. The election, of course, is the responsibility of the municipal unit. So some will obviously be in better financial shape than others. That's, you know, normal.
Hardship for municipalities to have to wait. The restart agreement outline was announced back in mid-July. It's been a long time. Are municipalities having trouble delivering services given this delay?
I don't know that they are. I haven't heard from any for some time. We did offer them, as I said, the $380 million loan package, which was there for them. We've certainly been meeting on a regular occasion. Our staff, deputy, and others have been meeting regularly with the NSFM, having discussions, and we'll continue to do that. Our relationship with the NSFM has always been good, and I think no reason for it not to be. We've been there. We've listened. We understand. We asked them. I asked them in meetings that I had. Give us your numbers. Tell us what your pain has been, you know, financially. And I know that when discussions were going on around the restart dollars, municipalities were a priority, as I said. A big priority for us in discussion, and that's being worked out, and I understand that we're getting close to having that resolved, and hopefully we'll have some news on that soon.
When you said give us your numbers, what numbers were you given? Were those the ones that the Federation put
the municipalities had provided us with numbers by way of their shortfall, and I think that number was public. I want to say it was around $63 million total is what they put forward. I think that's the number. We can go back and check for fact, Brian, for sure, but yep.
So can they expect something in that order?
I can't speak to that. I don't know the answer to that yet, but like I said, hopefully we'll have some news. I know that they're waiting. They're anxiously waiting, and we'll be, I'm sure, anxious to get it done as well.
And How much money did they draw down from the loan program?
Some has been drawn down. We can get you that number as well from the department if you want. I don't have that number today with me, but we've had a few. I don't know the number right off. I don't think it's like a big number, but we have had a few that have taken advantage of that. Yep.
I don't have record of anybody on the phone for a question with Minister Porter, but does anybody now have one?
Yes, thanks. This is Lindsay.
Hi, Lindsay, go ahead.
Looking at municipal elections, you mentioned that there may be some extra costs, even things like masks, hand sanitizers, wiping down doorknobs. Is there a plan to add funding to support municipal elections?
We haven't done that in the past, and at this time there isn't. I haven't had, to my knowledge, that I can recall any extra requests around that. I just have heard from others in the department that may be something that comes up. There may be some extra costs. I don't know what they've budgeted this year for that because that falls within their purview. So, but I would not be surprised, to be frank, I would not be surprised if there's additional costs. How could there not be with how you're doing it? But having said that, some municipalities are doing things differently. So the offset of how they're doing it may be a difference in how they would normally do it. There may be less cost the way they're actually doing it. I don't know. I'm not sure what those numbers are, but you could certainly ask any of the municipalities that are out there, and I'm sure they would be more than happy to tell you.
Lindsay, do you have a follow-up from Minister Porter?
Yes. If the consensus is across the board that municipalities are dealing with these expenses, are you willing to support that financially?
I think it's fair to say that, look, we've been listening to our municipalities. We've been working with our municipalities. We have put programs in place like the $380 million. It's certainly there for them. And we are looking forward to the restart program and dollars to see what that looks like going forward. So we'll assess all of that. But at this time, we don't have any other plan to offset any costs of municipal elections, which, again, are the responsibility of each municipal unit.
And that concludes our cabinet votes for... Andrew has one. We have about a minute left.
Different municipalities have gotten a bunch of provincial money for internet extension projects. And I know PICTO is going and is doing its own independent internet expansion project. But they've applied for money from the province. I don't know if you're aware of this. PICTO municipality has applied for money for the project. Money, and I'm just wondering, do you know anything about this, that they're having to fund their own internet?
I think that there are some municipalities out there that have taken that initiative on. Connect to Innovate, maybe a program that was there. We can get some detail for you if you like on that from the department, but I think it was Connect to Innovate, but there were programs available where municipalities are partners in the expansion of internet.
Fund, right? I'm not sure what the title of the fund is. It's like this week there was an announcement of a bunch of different.
So I think it's the Nova Scotia Internet.
Yeah, trust fund or something.
Oh, the trust
they applied
fund.
For money from that pot, but were denied that.
Yeah, I can't speak to that. I don't know the answer to that. Yeah, no, I don't know the answer. Sorry, Andrew. Don't know.
And that concludes our cabinet votes for today. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you.